Astronomy is often seen as an observational field, which it most certainly is, that tends to look at objects like stars, galaxies, and so on. But that's not all there is to the universe. And one of the most interesting projects of modern cosmology is looking at areas where there isn't anything, or more accurately, where objects are more sparse. These are known as voids, and the most mysterious of these that we currently know of is known as the local hole, or KBC void, because, well, frankly, it shouldn't exist. The local hole is vast and not to be confused with the much smaller local void. It's actually the largest type of cosmic void we know of that spans 2 billion light years. With the Milky Way being somewhere near the center, it has to be said that voids aren't really empty. There are galaxies in them, such as our own, rather they are better described as an underdensity, where there aren't as many galaxies as in other places. With this void, the underdensity is about 20% lower than the average, so it's not really a void, but astronomers call it that. The trouble with this void is that it actually violates a firmly held assumption in cosmology known as the cosmological principle. This is strange. The principle is the idea that if you look at the universe at very large scales, the distribution of matter should be uniform, isotropic, and homogeneous, because the forces acting on matter in the universe do so equally at very large scales. Not small scales, there you have variation, but very large scales. Yet the local hole violates it. The existence of the local hole is debated. There are still some arguments towards it not actually existing, and something with the observations are wrong. But the evidence continues to mount, causing astronomers to re-evaluate the situation. And indeed, other such giant voids have subsequently been discovered. But re-evaluating regarding the voids creates up against a lot of established cosmology that's based on observation, and may even require a rethink of gravity, something hinted at in other fields, such as studying dark matter if it actually exists. The cosmological principle idea is actually very old, going back to Isaac Newton. His argument was that the motion of objects in the universe is best explained by a universal law of gravitation, meaning that it acts the same anywhere in the universe. The cosmological principle does the same thing, but with the distribution of matter on large scales. In other words, at those scales, anywhere you look in the universe, it should look about the same. Only on smaller scales do you expect to see variations. Yet these gargantuan voids are too big, and they violate it. And there's another reason to think it's valid, the Big Bang. So the Big Bang cooks off, and soon the universe is an astoundingly dense ball until inflation occurs and it expands rapidly. That process of inflation should have kept things smooth as far as the density of matter in the universe, leading to a universe where the galaxies are more or less evenly distributed on large scales. Thus there should be no giant hole. The void stands against this. Despite the cosmological principle underlying a huge amount of cosmology and how the universe evolved, which is very successful with a ton of evidence. But there's also a hidden assumption here, again based on observational evidence, that the universe consists mostly of dark matter and dark energy. These are essential to our current understanding of the universe. In the case of the expansion of space, which is accelerating, like anything else, you need some kind of energy to drive it. That's dark energy. With dark matter, we see more gravity, far more than we should. Galaxies should be flying apart instead of holding together as they spin. Whatever is creating the gravity is invisible, and how that happens is if it only interacts gravitationally and in no other way. That's dark matter. Taken as a whole, the model predicts all sorts of things that have turned out to be correct. One of them is the amount of helium and deuterium that should be present in the universe after the Big Bang. It matches what we see. Another is the cosmic microwave background radiation, the afterglow of the Big Bang. We see it. It exists. Gravity as a whole also plays a role here, in that it can pull things around and create voids, but it's limited by how much time has elapsed since the Big Bang. In principle, this should set an upper limit on voids, something around 1.2 billion light years. The local hole exceeds it by a lot. But there's another issue that may be hinting that something's not quite right with our models. In 1989, the first of what are termed great walls was discovered. These are structures of multiple galaxies that are like the local hole, enormous, bigger than they should be, The Sloan Great Wall is 1.5 billion light years across, yet there's a vastly larger one. The Hercules Corona Borealis Great Wall clocks in at 10 billion light years across. Worse, a recent discovery in 2021 found not only one structure, but two clumped together. It's statistically very unlikely that you'd see two of them clumped together, so once again, it's a huge structure that should not exist like the local hole. And then there's the mystery of the Hubble tension at play here as well, hinting that something is wrong. In that case, our local area of the universe appears to show a different rate of expansion than other areas of the universe, meaning that our area is expanding faster than the rest of space. That's assuming, however, that there wasn't some misunderstanding of the data, causing various measurements to not agree, an open issue still. And there's yet another emerging mystery about the local hole. This is known as a bulk flow, which is just the motion of streams of galaxies and how fast they are moving. In the local hole, the rate that they are moving is 4 times faster than what our standard models predict. This is amounting to a whole lot of potentially related discrepancies indeed, and the bottom line is that all taken together appear to constitute a true crisis in cosmology, a term thrown around a bit too much because the standard model just doesn't resolve these discrepancies. So what does all of this mean? It means that some type of tweak needs to be applied to the models that can allow for enormous structures to form much faster than we realized. One would be to look at how strong gravity is at long distances. In other words, MOND again, modified Newtonian gravity, which does just that. We haven't yet tested the strength of gravity at great distances, that has to be said. The other option is that dark matter may be influencing everything gravitationally in a way we don't understand, and won't until we get a better handle on just what dark matter is. Dark matter may not be what we think it is. One key is we don't know how it's moving. If it's moving slowly, called cold dark matter, then it will produce one effect. It's just big subatomic particles moving around that don't like to interact. Here, small structures combine to form larger ones overall, but it could be the other way around, where dark matter is moving near or at the speed of light, as something like dark photons. And we know about something like this already, the neutrino. It's fast and doesn't usually interact. This is termed as hot dark matter. The implication of that is that structures would start large, then break down and get smaller, which would better explain the giant structures. And you have to mention the fifth force in nature, which there has been indications or hints might be there. And we might be in a situation where we simply don't know what the effect that has in all of this, if it indeed exists. We're working on 4 cylinders and paper when there are actually 5. With MOND, researchers looked into what might happen to the local void if it's real. And they found that, oddly enough, if MOND is correct, then it would result in galaxies in the void seemingly expanding faster, as in the Hubble tension, because of stronger acting gravity. The more abundant matter outside the void would be pulling more strongly on the galaxies within it. But this isn't the only mystery regarding structures in the universe that's cropped up recently. Here it's much smaller and very likely unrelated to whatever is going on with the large-scale structures, but it deals with galaxies themselves. Using the James Webb Space Telescope, researchers looked very deeply into the universe, looking at some of the oldest galaxies we've ever seen. We're looking back in time on the order of 12 billion years. It quickly became evident that something changed. This has been termed a crisis in cosmology as well, but it's really a lesser one. So previous looks at ancient galaxies could only look out so far, and anything previously seen was showing a normal rate of star formation, and also the chemical elements they produce. This was expected to also be seen with the earliest galaxies, and it's not. The earliest galaxies were producing significantly fewer heavy elements than what was predicted, 4 times fewer. Something changed. But the best answer so far has been that when those galaxies formed, there would have been a higher density of material from which to draw on for star formation that dissipated as the universe aged. Yet another discovery of Webb in this grain is that a galaxy known as ZF/UDS/7329 was observed, and it turns out that it's impossibly massive for a galaxy of its age. It actually contains more stars than the Milky Way, yet it formed just 800 million years after the Big Bang. This violates the models for how galaxies like this could be structurally that mature, that early, once again hinting that our standard models of cosmology may be at least partially incorrect, necessitating yet another tweak. But to do that, whatever solution is found is going to have to account for all observations and be consistent across the board, which is very challenging for any model. Mond is a good example of this. It may not account for all observations at the end of the day, and suggests that both the standard model and Mond were not the right answer, and that a new rethinking from the ground up would be needed. In some respects, but not all, it will be back to the drawing board for cosmology. Thanks for listening. I'm futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently still floored by the Aurora Borealis I saw. I'm not going to beat that one, even if I go to Iceland or Alaska. If you want to see what it looked like in Northern England, Eryn Knight, which is what Anna calls herself when she wants to trick people into thinking she's human, posted a video on her channel, link in the description below. And another tidbit, a lot of people were asking about more on the mysterious Vigner Electron Ice Crystal from my last News 10 list. Good news, I just finished interviewing one of the team that did it, Dr. Ali Yazdani, and we did a deep dive into the discovery. Look for it on Event Horizon in the coming weeks, and be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.